South Park has introduced a lot of characters over the years. Some are well-meaning and lovable. And then there are the demented characters who are memorable for the worst reasons.
You gonna break his legs, PC Principal?
There are a lot of reprehensible visitors to this small Colorado town. But among them, who are the worst? Hey guys, I'm Brad with Wicked Binge, and this is South Park Villains, Evil to Most Evil. For this list, we'll be covering the more memorable characters or forces who have earned the title of villains. Some will be one-time appearances, while others will be South Park residents we've come to know and despise. Coming in as our least evil, we have Trent Boyette. While he was a violent kid, capable of causing a lot of harm, we gave him some leniency. In flashbacks, Trent wasn't the best kid, picking on classmates and starting fires even in preschool. But we're willing to believe he would have grown out of it if given the chance. After all, he was arrested because he was blamed for a crime he didn't commit. He was in the wrong place at the wrong time, and his past actions destroyed his credibility. Even with his teacher trying to communicate, Trent was innocent. When he was hunting down Kyle, Stan, Kenny, and Eric, Trent made it clear that he only wanted to punish them for making him suffer. He attacked the boys that our protagonist hired to go after him only because they were in his way for revenge. Trent didn't get his closure, getting locked up again, but maybe we'll see him in a future episode. The second least evil villain's tears are so yummy. Scott Tinnerman. He was a little odd to place because he was a teenager that took to bullying like many older boys. After all, sixth graders in their early seasons thrived on terrorizing the younger kids. But Scott stood out as being shifty with how he went about using and mocking the kids in town, and Eric became his favorite to pick on. With that said, we're gonna go ahead and say that he didn't deserve to be fed his parents' dead bodies and home-cooked chili. Next is the Force of Walmart. When the superstore comes into South Park, it becomes an evil entity that drains the town of all life that doesn't center around the store. When the town gets a Walmart where Stark's Pond used to be, it starts influencing the residents to spend all their time and money there. We can't rank it lower since this is South Park we're talking about. We hear about a lot of towns being affected by the shopping center, but the people of South Park are very obsessive and over the top when it comes to anything they deem new and exciting. Even when Walmart is gone, they still cause trouble by building up a local shop to be the same powerhouse. Up next, we have Leslie. Leslie is a living embodiment of an advertisement. Her specialty is getting in a person's head to tell them what they want to hear, giving them the illusion of getting what they want. But there was a lot that was still unclear about her character. How much of her actions was she aware of? How much did she remember from her past work? And since she was a creation, blending humanity with technology, how much was she in control of her own actions? For these reasons, we didn't feel right about placing her lower, but there's no doubt that she was good at manipulating others and using sympathy to protect herself. Next, we have the short-lived character, Damien. Damien was the son of Satan, and he was chaotic, causing people to have animal parts, making demands to see Jesus so his father can fight him. However, Damien reveals, before he has to return to hell, that he only does evil because he has to. He expresses that he only wants to make friends like other children get to. While he made one other appearance, we haven't seen him featured in any other episodes. Hopefully, that will change in the future. We couldn't have a list without mentioning Mel Gibson. Though the man knows story structure, he does not know when to quit. We can respect his passion for his work, but chasing down a bus of people just to get a couple of bucks back from some kids unhappy with your movie is not a way to go, and the Braveheart face paint was overkill. Though he's reckless, and let's face it, insane, he wasn't the worst celebrity to visit South Park. Next up is a truly infamous creature, Man Bear Pig. Once believed to be a figment of Al Gore's imagination, it's later revealed that Man Bear Pig was a real threat, being used as a metaphor for climate change. The creature is always violent and willing to rip anyone and everyone to shreds, and nearly kills Kyle during Imagination Land. Unlike many on this list, Man Bear Pig is a near mindless beast. It doesn't have a lot of control over its own actions. While we drop him down a little further than others due to the extent of its actions, we don't feel right about calling it more evil since there wasn't much intent put into its violence. Next up, we have Nathan. Thriving on a hate for Jimmy, he's always trying to be the endearing young man that he, well, isn't. Over time, Nathan has learned to use his disability to his advantage, staying under the radar as he sells drugs and participates in other illegal activities.
Maybe I do, and maybe I don't.
Are you a cop?
He allows PC Principal to use him as ammunition to stop the Super School News newspaper and attempts to get Jimmy killed a few times at summer camp. Unfortunately for Nathan, though he gets away with a lot, he normally gets punished for his bitterness and desire for revenge. Because of his antics over the years, we had to include Randy Marsh. One of the most erratic members in town, you know an episode is gonna have a bunch of ridiculous moments when Randy is the focus. He claims to have values he stands behind, but more often than not, Randy is the cause of mass hysteria and confusion. He neglects his family for a good time and often gets into trouble with the amount of alcohol he drinks.
What seems to be the officer problem?
He's willing to do anything for status, often letting his ego make his choices for him. The most we can say is that there are times he tries to bond with his children, but he's also guilty of killing a kid while dressed as Spider-Man, causing the town to break down when everyone becomes obsessed with their debt, tries killing people after being influenced by the blockbuster, and, you know, the list goes on forever. Next is the Prince of Darkness, Satan. Though he is the Lord of Darkness, he understands humanity, explains why people sin, and tells Stan why addictive behavior is so crippling in certain people. His story is a tragic one, with him always seeking out a partner that will make him happy and not treat him like garbage. While not the best dad, he doesn't beat Damien like some other parents do to their own children. Satan even stopped his plans to take over the Earth when he got rid of Saddam, and Kenny offered to give up his soul for the safety of his friends and family. Up next, we have Mr. Garrison, and to a lesser extent, Mr. Hat. Since Mr. Hat was an extension of Mr. Garrison and his internal struggle with himself, we felt it was fitting to place them in the same ranking. Garrison is a mess, always struggling with his identity and what he wants out of life. He takes his anger out on everyone else, lashing out at his students and the other residents. His anger even gets him enough attention to have him run for president. Garrison may have been one of the brighter minds of South Park, but he was always one of the most unstable and unpredictable. Let's not forget Rob Reiner. Appearing to help teach children the dangers of smoking, he was not the great guy he presented himself to be. After taking a tour of a tobacco factory with the boys, Reiner approached Eric with the offer to star in a commercial. Unfortunately for Eric, the ad was set up to lie about Eric having lung cancer from secondhand smoke, after which Reiner tried killing Eric to hold up the lie, claiming it was for the greater good. While we have no problem with people becoming aware of the dangers of smoking, hunting down children or anyone else just to scare the masses onto your side is a drastic and irrational tactic. Next is Ike's former teacher, Miss Stevenson. We had to include her for her abuse of her position as a teacher to seduce Ike into a relationship he clearly wasn't ready for. Miss Stevenson had a lot of problems. She was convinced that she and Ike were soulmates and tried to get him to commit suicide with her. Always singing a catchy tune, we have Mr. Guillermo next. Mr. Guillermo is your typical overly strict father character. He's always demanding his family think and act how he says. And when he doesn't get his way, his go-to is to slap his son and wife until they give in.
I will slap your face so super hard.
The reason he's placed here on our list is because by the end of the episode, his methods are ineffective. Once his son and wife stand up for themselves, he's left with adapting to how they want to live their lives. Next is an early season villain, Veronica the Succubus. When the boys are at risk of losing Chef to a new bride, they confide in Mr. Garrison, who suggests that the woman is a succubus from hell, intent on seducing Chef in order to slowly drain the life from him. As it turns out, Garrison was right. When the boys sing, "There's Gotta Be a Morning After," in reverse, Veronica's true form is revealed, and she's dragged back into hell. Next is Stan's goldfish. He's one of the villains to feature in an early Halloween special. This fish is responsible for the death of several South Park residents, but we cut the pet some slack because, though a terror, the fish came from a pet store linked to a darker reality. And that brings into light a lot of questions on how much say the fish had in its own actions. Next on our list, we're placing Cthulhu and his followers together. After an oil drill accidentally reaches another dimension, Cthulhu rises to cause mass destruction. Cthulhu is initially easy to brush off as mindless, but it's easy to sympathize with him being pushed around by Eric. As for his followers, they were not so easy to forgive. We learned that Kenny's parents were members, leading to Kenny gaining his inability to stay dead. While Kenny has done a lot of good throughout the series, both as Mysterion and as himself, This cult led to endless suffering for an innocent child. Next, we have the powerhouse, Mickey Mouse. South Park has poked fun at a lot of franchises, and Disney is no exception. When the Jonas Brothers were gaining popularity and touring, promoting the purity rings, Mickey was pulling the strings. And when there was a chance of his employees talking back to him and not giving him his way, Mickey put a stop to it in brutal fashion. In one scene, he beats one of the brothers to the ground before kicking him over and over again, demanding submission. And when things were at risk at the concert, Mickey held our main protagonist hostage, unknowingly spilling his true intentions before a national audience. Even after being exposed, Mickey didn't pull back to regroup and find a way to save his image. Instead, he became a flame-breathing dragon, terrorizing the city. Next on our list is Grand Moss Stotch. As we covered previously, Butters doesn't have the best life. His parents never believe him and punish Butters for almost everything he does or doesn't do. And one of the many times his parents dropped the ball was when they allowed Grandma Stotch to be around their son. This woman is bitter and malicious. Whenever she's around Butters, she allows the worst of herself to come out, hitting him, stabbing him with forks under the table, and mocking him for being a coward. Next is a character that has fallen far from grace. We have Gerald Brufflovsky, or maybe we should call him by his troll name, Skank Hunt 42. Gerald was once regarded as one of the most sensible members of South Park, though always greedy for more money and better stuff to fill a big house. But over the years, he's channeled his narcissism into becoming a troll online. Trolls are annoying enough to deal with, but Gerald was relentless, attacking everyone that crossed his path. Men, women, children. His harassment even led to a woman taking her life and marking him as an enemy of Denmark. And when his life was on the line with other trolls, Gerald made the sleazy call to try to throw his own kid under the bus. We're placing the infamous Mecha Streisand next. When Barbara came to South Park seeking out the Triangle of Xynthar, she tortured the boys with her singing. Power-hungry and egotistic, she goes on a rampage as her Mecha form, stopping only to sign an autograph. Luckily, she was defeated. The Diamond of Pantheo still stuck around to do more damage. While he wasn't on the show long, we have to include Charles Manson. In an early episode, Stan, Kenny, and Kyle accompany Eric and Leanne to visit more of the Cartman family in Nebraska. During the holiday, Eric's Uncle Howard shows up in the home by sneaking into the basement, his cellmate in tow. The episode is an odd one, with Charles Manson being converted by a special of How the Grinch Stole Christmas. The episode showed a divide between Stan and his parents, and it ended with, oddly enough, Charles Manson telling Stan the importance of family before turning himself into the police. We still have to drop him far on the list for what landed him in jail in the first place. We can't forget Saddam. While there may have been a few warlords on the show, Saddam was a special case. He was a major player in a couple of episodes after the movie. Not only was Saddam known for his bloodlust and craving of power, but among the fan base, he's mainly seen as a guy that treated Satan like trash when they were dating. Saddam is controlling, whether it be in relationships or taking over the world during the end of days. It was nice to see Satan finally learn to stand up to him. Next is Eric Cartman, a character we all love to hate to some degree. One of the main protagonists, he's also been an enemy. In fact, the amount of stuff Eric is guilty of could be a video all on its own. But to name a few, he used a makeshift church to scam people out of thousands of dollars. He wanted to be a hero simply for the fame of it. He held Kyle at gunpoint while they were at risk of dying just to get a satchel of gold. He fed a boy's parents to him using chili. He tried getting his girlfriend kidnapped and possibly killed just because he was tired of her, and the list goes on and on. The only reason we don't place Eric lower on this list is because he is capable of being well-behaved after Caesar helps Linda discipline him.
Discipline.
Eric is a hurt kid who uses anger and animosity as a defense, and there were moments he risked his life to save Kyle, though he would never admit to that. Next are some of the worst parents on the show. We have Linda and Steven Stotch. Their treatment of their son is well known, whether you watch every episode or not. They're known for grounding Butters for ridiculous reasons, but they've also been guilty of some other insane parenting methods. For instance, in an early episode, we have what seems to be a normal family dynamic, with Linda asking her son if he can spy on his father to see what Steven had planned for their anniversary. But when Butters unknowingly reveals that his father is sleeping with other men, Linda snaps. Her solution is to drown her son in the car and hang herself. When that failed, the couple made up a story about their son being kidnapped. And that's only one example of their poor judgment. As for Steven, He jumped on board with the idea of selling Butters off to Paris Hilton, telling Butters if he wanted to avoid being sold, he'd have to dig coal to earn the money himself. And when Paris was taken out by Mr. Slave, Stephen's response was to ground Butters since he now couldn't be sold. Taking our bronze medal of evil, we have Christopher Reeve. We mentioned him in our celebrity list, but we think his actions were so revolting, we had to include him among the villains. Once an actor that played one of the most iconic superheroes in this universe, he fell from grace in the worst possible way. At first, he seems like a celebrity hired to promote the use and understanding of stem cells, but the more he's seen, the more monstrous he becomes, feeding on unborn children to make himself stronger. Our silver medal of evil is split between three equally evil organizations: NAMBLA, the group of Catholic priests, and the Super Adventure Club. These are three completely different groups that are seen throughout the series, but the thing that connects them is the reprehensible exploitation of children. The boys encounter NAMBLA early on, and they were happy to give a bunch of ridiculous justifications for their actions even as they were being arrested. The Catholic priests had been unveiled by Father Maxie in a later episode, but even after Maxie tried exposing them, they refused to stop their actions. Instead, they tried to get Maxie to admit to participating, and thought the reason Maxie was there to find a way to get the young boys of South Park to not expose him. As for the Super Adventure Club, they weren't focused on a particular group or region. They went all over the world to find victims and more members to brainwash, including the beloved chef. Of course, we had to give the gold medal of evil to the Woodland Critters. First appearing in a South Park Christmas special, these characters look kinda cuddly, until you realize these have become the most feared even among the evildoers in Imagination Land.
Nobody here has AIDS!
They're manipulative and are experts at using guilt to get their way, much like the kid who created them. Blood orgies, torture, sacrificing one another to appease the Dark Lord, these are some messed up characters, even by villainous standards. They're meant to be a representation of the most pure form of evil, so we felt it was safe to give them the gold medal. Alright guys, what do you think? Who are the most evil villains in South Park? And remember to check out our South Park Celebrities Good to Evil video. Don't forget to hit that notification bell and binge our Good to Evil playlist, where we break down the morality of the characters in your favorite cartoons, shows, and movies. But most importantly, stay wicked.